Some people think everything is political. I'm one of those people, and I'd be willing to bet large sums of money that our guest tonight is also one of those people. I've been an admirer of Dave Zirin's work for many years. I'm absolutely delighted to be able to welcome him to our campus this evening. Dave Zirin really kind of represents the perfect union between the two graduate programs of sports media and media literacy and digital culture. Because as a devoted sports fan whose work focuses on issues of politics and race and gender and class as they apply to the world of sports, Mr. Zirin challenges us to understand that sports are more than just entertainment. No matter what we like to tell ourselves, there's a lot more happening when we watch a game on television or attend it live than just the contest that we see before us on the field. A crucial part of global culture, in some ways, the sporting world is maybe the most naked place where issues of social justice play out. And Dave Zirin has been writing about this and speaking about it for many years. A quick little bit from his bio. He was named one of Utney Reader's 50 visionaries who are changing our world. I'm not on that list. He writes about the politics of sports for The Nation magazine, and he's also a columnist for Slam magazine and The Progressive. He hosts a weekly radio show, The Edge of Sports Radio. It says on his bio that he's the author of 8 books on the politics of sports, but he's very prolific, so my guess is that that needs to be updated, and it's probably more than that by now.
We could talk in the Q&A.
He's been called the best sports writer in the United States by Robert Lipsight and by me.
Oh, thank you. Damn.
His most famous book, maybe the place to start, A People's History of Sports, which in my estimation is the second history book that everybody should read. Sorry, second, you know. The first is A People's History of the U.S. by Howard Zinn. Yeah. But A People's History of Sport is very much modeled in that type of tradition. It's my absolute pleasure to welcome Dave Zirin.
Wow, thank you. Wow, thank you so much. Thanks, everybody, for coming out on this UConn-heavy evening that you have before you. Before I start, this actually helps me when I speak to an audience. Like, how many people here consider yourselves like diehard sports fans? Like, absolute diehards. Like, how many people here consider yourself like, you know, so-so sports fan? Like, you follow what's going on, but you're not an obsessive about it. Okay. And how many people would rather shave your head with a cheese grater than hear somebody talk about sports for 40 minutes? Okay. Great. What's your name, ma'am, if I can ask you? Oh, I meant the woman behind you. But no, right behind you. Angela, okay, and we got Matt, too. Okay, great. Well, the goal for this talk is to do something that ideally speaks to the diehard sports fan, the casual sports fan, and Angela and Matt. If we could do that, we'll have this taken care of, no problem. Now, I grew up in New York City. One of those absolute diehard sports fan. I played every sport. I was the starting center for my school's basketball team. We sucked. I mean, I'm not tall. And I mean, for me, sports was everything growing up, absolutely everything. My room was a shrine to the sports stars of New York City of that time. I don't even know if you guys have heard of some of these folks, but you could throw up your hands if you've heard of these guys. Like my room was like ceiling to floor posters of people like Daryl Strawberry, Keith Hernandez, Lawrence Taylor. I mean, I didn't know at the time they all had serious cocaine problems. No, seriously, looking back in retrospect, my room was like the Pablo Escobar All-Stars. It was kind of embarrassing. But I love those guys, and I love sports. I played every sport except for golf, which to me, not a sport, which we can debate if we want to later. But I just think that anything that you can gain weight or smoke cigarettes while doing is not a sport. That's my line on what is or isn't a sport. But I didn't care about the politics of sport. That didn't mean anything to me. But that changed a great deal when a basketball player by the name of Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf in 1996 made the private decision that he wasn't going to come out for the national anthem before games. And at the time, in this pre-social media stone age, it was the sort of thing that nobody noticed for a couple of games. But then an enterprising young reporter in Denver got word of it and went into the locker room and said to him, "How can you not go out there for the national anthem? Don't you realize that that flag is a symbol of freedom and equality throughout the world?" And you should find the video of this, because Rauf has this look on his face like, should I say something? I think I'm going to say something. It's like he could see him like arguing in his own brain what he's going to say to that. And sure enough, he said, "Well, it may be a symbol of freedom and equality to some, but it's a symbol of oppression and tyranny to others." Now, when he said that, I mean, the sports world just was turned on its head. I'll never forget ESPN was like, "Rauf spits on the flag, booyah, da-na-na, da-na-na." And I remember watching this, and one of the talking heads on ESPN said, in kind of a dismissive way, he said, "Rauf must see himself as one of those athlete activists, people like Muhammad Ali or Billie Jean King." And I remember hearing that and thinking to myself, wait a minute, athlete activists, what the hell is that? Like, I thought I knew so much about sports, and I had no idea what they were talking about. And that's what really started me on this journey of trying to figure out how people have actually used this hyper-exalted, brought-to-you-by-Nike platform called sports to try to change the world. And that led me down a lot of very interesting paths. And one of the things that I learned is that so much of what I thought I knew about conventional sports history actually was not the way it was, that history is much more complicated and much more messy than some of the traditional narratives that we hear. I mean, one example is, you know, I was born in Brooklyn and raised in Manhattan, and my whole family's from Brooklyn, and I was raised with this idea of Jackie Robinson. And I learned that Jackie Robinson, through his own brilliance, was able to integrate Major League Baseball in 1947. What I didn't know was that in the 1930s, there was actually a movement in this country to integrate baseball, a powerful movement. And people marched, and people protested, and people had banners that said things like, "End Jim Crow in baseball." And it was led by a guy named Lester Red Rodney. And Lester Rodney was the sports editor of the Communist Party's newspaper, The Daily Worker. And it's a wild thing to think about, because, I mean, for those young folks, you know, Lester Rodney, he was considered himself a socialist. For those that don't know socialism, that's like the guy running for president, Ted Cruz. No, I'm just kidding. Bernie Sanders. But what Lester Rodney was trying to do with his sports page was use it as a place to agitate for the integration of Major League Baseball. And it was ahead of its time, the kind of media stunts that he would pull for the 1930s, which was pretty remarkable. Like, the Yankees would do things like hold open tryouts to make the team. It was like a publicity thing they would do. And Lester Rodney would show up with African-American ballplayers and dare the Yankees to not let them try out. And the Yankees would sort of be forced to let them try out because the media would be all around. And that was really groundbreaking at the time. And the African-American ballplayers, they weren't just props for Lester Rodney. They were part of an organization called the African Black Brotherhood. And they would go in there with Lester Rodney with the idea of challenging the idea that they didn't belong on that field. Lester Rodney also had a press pass, and he would be there in the locker room talking to players. And there's a famous story where a bunch of journalists were around this rookie for the Yankees, this guy named Joe DiMaggio. And they say to Joe DiMaggio, like, "Hey, Jolton Joe, who's the best pitcher you ever faced?" And Joe DiMaggio, who was a teenager at the time and, you know, wasn't thinking about politics at all, just answering honestly, he said, "Gee, I think the best pitcher I ever faced was Satchel Paige." And you could have heard a pin drop in the locker room, because Satchel Paige was, of course, a Negro League star who Joe DiMaggio had played against on the West Coast in some exhibition games. And the next day, not one newspaper reported that Joe DiMaggio had said that. except for the Daily Worker, which in a huge font says, DiMaggio says Page is the best, exclamation point, exclamation point. And I got to learn all these stories because Lester Rodney lived to be 96 years old. And I got to interview him for hours and hours at a time in his retirement community in Oakland. And he just had all these amazing stories. He was sharp as a tack. He was actually the age 85 and older national tennis champion for 3 straight years. Believe it or not, that's a thing. I don't know how thick the competition is, but Lester Rodney dominated. And I'll never forget talking to Lester Rodney, and he's telling me stories about like covering Joe Louis in 1936 and all this crazy stuff. And him saying to me, why do you even care about this? Who the hell cares what happened 70 years ago? And I said, well, it matters because it's this whole alternative history. And I think that I can go around and tell your story and people will be interested in it because it's like this hidden history of sports and people don't know about the movement of the 30s. And Lester looked at me and he said, ah, to be 80 again, which was kind of awesome. And Lester passed away in 2010. And when he passed away, more people did know who he was, less because of my efforts and more because he was embraced by Rachel Robinson, Jackie Robinson's widow, who wanted people to know the contributions that Lester made. And they did these events together and whatnot. And it also led me to down the path when I was talking to Lester Rodney of learning more about who Jackie Robinson was. And I really want to encourage people next week. Ken Burns has a documentary out on PBS, a two-night documentary about Jackie Robinson. I've already seen it, and it is brilliant. I mean, it's like the antithesis of 42, which we can talk about later why that's so important. But when you see Ken Burns' documentary and when you talk to Lester and when you dig deep into the Jackie Robinson story, one of the things that you see is that this idea of Jackie Robinson, which is, I think, portrayed really strongly in 42, that he was kind of like this lone wolf who through his individual genius was able to overcome racism. That's not who Jackie Robinson was. He was a barnstorming speaker for civil rights. And he believed passionately in the idea that his individual genius and greatness should not blind white America to the racism that existed in the world. And it's actually interesting. For the book I did, People's History of Sports, did some digging into the NAACP's records. And Jackie Robinson was actually the most requested speaker for southern branches of the NAACP. The number two most requested speaker was this guy you might have heard of named Martin Luther King. And I always found that kind of hilarious because you imagine like people like the professor here and the program director here like sitting around being like, we got to bring in a speaker. Who can we get? Can we get Jackie Robinson? He's busy. All right, let's get Dr. King. God damn it, I can't believe we have to settle for Dr. King. Like the idea that he would be anybody's second choice. But that's how powerful Jackie Robinson was. And King acknowledged that, calling Jackie Robinson a sit-inner before sit-ins, a freedom rider before freedom rides. And when Jackie Robinson would end his speeches, he would always end this way. He would say, if I had to choose between the Baseball Hall of Fame and full citizenship for my people, I would choose full citizenship time and again. And it would just bring the house down. And that's who Jackie was. So the Jackie Robinson I thought I knew was not the Jackie Robinson who was. And the same thing is true about another athlete who I'm guessing folks have heard of by the name of Muhammad Ali. And I've done a lot of writing about Muhammad Ali, frankly, because I find him endlessly fascinating. Like this idea that the most famous athlete in the United States had one foot in the black freedom struggle and one foot in the anti-war movement. But honestly, my knowledge of Ali before digging into it was like, I got the idea that, you know, that he was political. But most of all, I knew him as the guy who's just like, you know, I hospitalized a rock, I beat up a brick, I'm so bad I make medicine sick. Ah, you know, and people were like, oh, he rhymes, that's amazing. But when I dug into it, what's so fascinating about it is 1960, his name is Cassius Marcellus Clay Jr. He wins the gold medal, and his dream in 1960 was to bring the showmanship of professional wrestling into boxing. And if you'd asked him who his hero was in 1960, he wouldn't have said Malcolm X. He would not have said the people who were sitting in at lunch counters in the South. He would have said Gorgeous George Wagner, who was a professional wrestler at that time, a great professional wrestler, but that's maybe a parallel discussion we can have later about pro wrestling. But as the 1960s took place, and when he came back with a gold medal around his neck and couldn't get served in a restaurant in his hometown, his politics changed dramatically, and he joined the Nation of Islam, and he changed his name to Muhammad Ali. And I want to give people a sense, like, of the radical Ali, because when it comes to his politics, one thing that I knew, and maybe people have heard this quote as well, is that he said, I ain't got no quarrel with them Viet Cong, because he opposed the war in Vietnam. And they said, why aren't you going over there to fight? Why aren't you doing exhibition matches? And he said he wouldn't be drafted because he said, I ain't got no quarrel with them Viet Cong. And that's, to me, what I thought the extent of his politics were. But I'd like to read to you a speech that he gave, because it gives you a better idea of the kind of things he was saying, because it really blows my mind. So one time he was in Louisville, Kentucky, his hometown, where there was a housing dispute taking place. There was a fight for low-income housing. And he was being pestered about the war, like, why aren't you going in the draft? Why aren't you fighting in Vietnam? And this is what he said. He said, why should they ask me to put on a uniform and go 10,000 miles from home and drop bombs and bullets on brown people in Vietnam while so-called Negro people in Louisville are treated like dogs and denied simple human rights? This is the day when such evils must come to an end. I've been warned that to take such a stand would cost me millions of dollars, but I've said it before and I'll say it again. The real enemy of my people is here. I'll go to jail, so what? We've been in jail for 400 years. It's like, damn, I mean, this is the most famous athlete using his platform to say that. And so if you think people today like Cam Newton get a hard time in the press, it is no comparison to the kind of things that Muhammad Ali had to deal with. And I want to give an example. The most famous sports writer back then was probably a guy named Jimmy Cannon. And this is Jimmy Cannon's response to Muhammad Ali. And before I read this, please know that he calls Muhammad Ali Clay, because that was what most newspapers, both the white press and the black press, did at that time. Because Muhammad Ali got it from both sides. Like, the black press did not like the fact that he had joined the Nation of Islam either, because they were such critics of the civil rights movement and Dr. King. And the white press didn't like him because he was Louisville Lip. He was Cash the Brash. They called him Gaseous Cassius because they felt like he talked too much. And they had policies against even calling him Muhammad Ali. I mean, the New York Times, which most people, you hear that and you think, you know, that's a liberal paper, quote unquote. They had an editorial policy that lasted until 1970, that he was not allowed to be referred to as Muhammad Ali. So that's 1964 to 1970. They didn't call him by his name. And I want to read to you, if I could, what Jimmy Cannon said, because it gives you an idea of what he dealt with. He said, Clay, remember he called him Clay, he says, Clay fits in with the famous singers no one can hear, and the punks riding motorcycles, and Batman. I don't know why Batman was such a big deal at the time. And the boys with their long, dirty hair, and the girls with that unwashed look, and the college kids dancing naked at secret proms. That wasn't my college. I don't know what y'all doing here, but that's what they said. He said, and the painters who copy the labels off of soup cans, and the surf bums who refuse to work, and the whole pampered cult of the bored young. I mean, that's like a Donald Trump speech. That is crazy. But that's the sort of thing that they unloaded on Muhammad Ali. But his power is something that I think we have underestimated dramatically when we talk about U.S. history of that time. And I want to give a couple examples of that power that he had at that time. I mean, people might be familiar with when Dr. Martin Luther King in 1967 came out against the war in Vietnam in what was called the Riverside Church speech. And that was a huge deal at the time, because Dr. King's own advisors said to him that he shouldn't talk about U.S. foreign policy and that he should stick to, quote unquote, domestic matters. And before Dr. King gave his speech at Riverside Church, he was being pestered by the media asking why he was doing it. And King's response was, well, it's like Muhammad Ali teaches us, these issues are connected. So Dr. King was referencing Muhammad Ali to explain why he was coming out against the war in Vietnam. Or Nelson Mandela. I mean, Nelson Mandela, who at the time was at Robben Island Prison, one of the most notorious prisons in the world, eventually got out and came to the United States, one of his first stops was to actually meet with Muhammad Ali. And he said he was doing so because with every Muhammad Ali fight, this is a paraphrase of what Mandela said, he said he felt like the walls of the prison were being broken down. And it made him feel that much more human and that much more connected with the outside world. And he inspired people, too, in a pretty dramatic way. People may have seen that there was a very high-profile documentary about the Black Panther Party on PBS recently. It's called Vanguard of the Revolution. If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend it. It was a great documentary. It's 2 hours long. Obviously, they can't include everything. But a couple things that they didn't include was Muhammad Ali's impact on the very formation of the Black Panther Party. Two stories about that. The first is that Huey Newton, who was one of the founders of the Panthers, was inspired to do so after hearing Muhammad Ali and Malcolm X speak together. And Huey Newton was not somebody who was religious. So he said, I want their energy, I want their passion, I want what they're doing, but I want to make an organization that's not built around religion. But he inspired Huey Newton to do something. The other one impact is people might be familiar with this history, but the first time a panther was ever used in any political context was in Lowndes County, Alabama, where there was a voting rights drive going on to build a non-racist version of the Democratic Party in Lowndes County. And their symbol was a silhouette of a Black Panther. And it was the first time a panther had ever been seen as in any sort of political context in the 60s. And the slogan underneath the panther was, "We are the greatest." They took Muhammad Ali's "I am the greatest" and they made it plural. And I'll give another example as well. And this was something, I'm always learning stuff about this too, which is one of the cool things about speaking about this. I recently did a talk in Kansas, and people might know that the most famous athlete in the history of Kansas, that actually would be an interesting question to debate. Like some people say, it might be Danny Manning, Wilt Chamberlain, Lynette Woodard, who was the first woman to ever play for the Harlem Globetrotters, Billy Mills, the great 1964 Olympian. But somebody who's on that list, if you're talking about the greatest athlete Kansas ever produced, would be Gale Sayers, great running back. Gale Sayers, in 1965, was part of a movement on the campus of Kansas, because as recently as 65, Black people were not allowed to live on campus in Lawrence. They had to live off campus. And even though Gale Sayers was the hero of the football team, he had to live off campus. So Gale Sayers was part of the sit-ins that took place all over campus. They sat in the dean's office, the admissions office, the housing office. And one of the things one of the old-timers at Kansas told me, who was around back then, was he said, all of us were like, who were really in the know, were like, which building is Gale Sayers going to sit in? Because we know if we sit in that building, we're not going to get beat up by the police afterwards or have to spend a night in jail. They'll go easy on us because everybody loved Gale Sayers. And Gale Sayers was totally inspired by Muhammad Ali. And other people who were inspired by Muhammad Ali are these folks up here. Now, just as a show of hands, if you've seen this picture before, by the way. Yes. Tommy Smith, John Carlos, the 1968 Olympics at Mexico City. A lot of people know this moment, but don't know that it was also a movement called the Olympic Project for Human Rights that had been going on for several years. And this was a movement of primarily Black athletes who were pledging to boycott the 1968 Olympics unless a series of their demands were met. And they had four central demands. One was to hire more Black coaches, because at the time there was one on the entire USA track and field team. One of their demands was Avery Brundage, who was the head of the International Olympic Committee, to step down. If you don't know who Avery Brundage was, it's enough to say that he fought for the Olympics to be in Hitler's Germany in 1936, and athletes nicknamed him Slavery Avery. That's probably enough to let you know what they thought of him. One of their demands was for South Africa and Rhodesia to be disinvited from the Olympics because they were apartheid countries. And their fourth demand was that Muhammad Ali should have his title restored because it had been taken away from him for his opposition to the war in Vietnam. And they called Muhammad Ali, quote, the warrior saint of the Black athletes' revolt. So they were deeply inspired by Muhammad Ali. And that's what this movement was about. Now, the boycott movement actually fell through, but they still felt like they had to do something, and that's where we got to this moment. And I wanted to have this picture up behind me while I spoke, because there's so much visually going on here that we don't see when we just look at the photo. Because a lot of people see this, and they see the black gloves, and that's all they see. But if you notice here, they're also wearing beads and scarves, which were supposed to be a symbol about the history of lynching in the United States. You can't see it because the picture's cut off, but they're not wearing shoes on the Olympic platform, which was to symbolize poverty in the United States. And they're also wearing these buttons right here, which say Olympic Project for Human Rights. And if you notice, this person's wearing a button too. And a lot of people see this picture and they think that this guy's like Forrest Gump or something. Like he's just standing here and he's sort of like, oh wow, history, how interesting. But this is an Australian runner named Peter Norman. And Peter Norman was absolutely down with everything they were doing. And that's why he's wearing this button as well. And he suffered for the rest of his life back in Australia for doing this. And his story is actually a really sad one. But he never relented. And when he passed away way too young in 2006, the two lead pallbearers at his funeral were Tommy Smith and John Carlos. I mean, they were brothers for life. And I'm very familiar with this story, just so you know, because I wrote a book with John Carlos, and we've traveled around the country together, stayed in hotel rooms, slept on floors, all that stuff. So I've gotten to hear like a lot of crazy, crazy stories from John, because he has a lot of crazy stories. But one of the things that John always pointed out to me, and I'll ask you guys this too, is keep in mind, they before the race, the 200-meter finals, they brought the gloves, they brought the beads, they brought the scarves, they brought the buttons, but what did they have to do? They had to win. I mean, it would have been pretty awful if they just were like, damn, we came in eighth. We brought all this stuff. Yeah, that would have. But it gives you an idea of just how confident they were, how much swagger they had, that they were like, we can do this, and we'll be on this medal stand together, and we will make this statement together. And I want to encourage people, if you've never done it, to actually go online. It's very easy to do on YouTube, and actually watch the race. Because I don't know if anybody here is a sprinter or ever did sprinting, 100 meter, 200 meter, but one of the first things they tell you is you keep your head forward at all times. You know, you are looking at that tape, and that is the only thing you're focused on. Watch this race, and what you'll see is that John Carlos gets out to a big lead at the start, and he's constantly looking backwards. Like, where's Tommy? Where's Tommy? Where's Tommy? Just like he runs literally half of this Olympic-level race like this. Like, and he told me, John said to me, that he's saying under his breath, come on, Tommy, stop bullshitting. And Tommy eventually gets his kick in and bam, like gets right past him. And if you look at John, he's looking at Tommy and like, yeah, like going like this. And Peter Norman's right over here on the other side. And Tommy's like, and John's like, shit, you know, because Peter Norman just nipped him for the silver. And John said like he had this like conflicting emotion, like, oh, damn, I was supposed to win the silver. And I've been looking back. Oh, thank God, it's Peter Norman. He's down with us. This will work. So they felt that really, really tightly. And then, of course, they were had to go up to that medal stand and take this step. And as they're walking there, Tommy looks at John and says, has a moment of doubt, and says, what happens if we go up there and somebody tries to shoot us? Now, that might seem like a little bit crazy or out there, but you got to think about what was happening at this time. This is October 1968. So already that year, Martin Luther King Jr. assassinated, Bobby Kennedy assassinated. Before these Olympics start, days before they start, hundreds of Mexican students and workers were killed, massacred, in what's known to this day in Mexico City as the Massacre of Tlatelolco Square or the Massacre of Tlatelolco Plaza. And there's been a fight in Mexico for almost five decades now to get justice and recognition for the hundreds and hundreds of people who were killed before the start of the Olympics. So it made perfect sense, and they knew about all this too. So Tommy looks at John and he says, what happens if somebody tries to shoot us? And John looks at him and he says, well, you know, we're trained to listen for the gun, and, which is kind of a badass thing to say. And he says, and you know, we're fast, so we'll figure it out. So they get up on the medal stand, they raise their fists, and as John said to me, he said, you could have heard a frog piss on cotton. That's how quiet it was. And then the boos started, and then debris started to rain down on their heads, like actual garbage. People were thrown at them. They were kicked out of the Olympic Village. They were told to leave the country. They spread a lie that their medals were taken away. That's not actually true, though. They did go to their hotel room and say, we want to take your medals. And John looked at them and he said, but wait a minute, I don't see your army. And so they didn't take the medals. And John has it to this day. It's with John's mother, who is 97 years old in North Carolina, to this day. So, but that's what they were going through, and it mattered to them. And the thing is, they then entered this wilderness where they were completely shut out of organized sports. I mean, they suffered for what they did, suffered terribly for what they did. But when John and I, when we were touring for the book, I'll never forget at one event, he said to the crowd, he said, a lot of people ask me if I have any regrets. And he said, I have no regrets. The people who have regrets are the people who were there with us in 1968 and chose not to stand with us. Because they have to spend now the rest of their lives being asked the question, those guys raised their fists, where were you? What did you do? They have regrets. I don't. And so that's this story of 1968. Now, obviously, I'm talking a great deal, and I will speak more about the history of sports and politics through the lens of race. But, I mean, you could tell the history of this country about the history of women, the history of LGBT people, the history of workers in this country, and use the lens of sports and tell it in a very dynamic way. Like, to tell the history, for example, of women in this country through sports, it really is fascinating because at the end of the 19th century, sports was something that most women were just denied, organized sports. I mean, they were organized by men for men, largely for white men. Things like the YMCA started, public school athletic league started. They were funded by the wealthy industrialists of the late 19th century as a way of Americanizing the millions of European immigrants who were coming into this country. And for women, whether they were, you know, women from established families or poor families, sports, physical activity was just something they were not allowed to do. Now, that's not true in every case, but like wealthy women had access to sports, but it wasn't something that would sound attractive to anybody. Like they really only had access to three sports. It was like, from what I've seen, it's like horseback riding, golf, which as we discussed, not a sport. And the third one was tennis. Now, tennis was really ugly for women around this time. Like, have you ever wondered why women's tennis is the best of three sets and not the best of five? It actually was the best of five sets. You look back at early Wimbledon scores, for example, in the turn of the 20th century, it is best of five sets. But women had to play wearing corsets, like actual, like full five-set matches wearing corsets and hoop skirts. And it was very common for women to pass out on the court while they were playing. And so the people who ran Wimbledon got together and they said, we got to do something about this. What are we going to do? Should we get rid of the corsets? No, let's keep the corsets, but let's make it best of three sets instead of best of five because there's less of a chance that somebody will die. And that actually maintained itself for decades until a 15-year-old won Wimbledon named Lottie Dodd, and she made an impassioned plea to the organizers of Wimbledon and said that the event would have been so much more thrilling if my opponents had been allowed to breathe. And that kind of shamed them into finally getting rid of the corsets for Wimbledon and getting rid of them as sort of a standard uniform for tennis in general. But it was a crazy time to actually be a woman who wanted to play sports because every institution in society was lined up against you. And you go back and you look at it, and it's the Journal of American Medicine, it's the church, it's politics, it's all of these forces of power saying that sports would somehow unlock women into this state where they would, I mean, it's crazy when you read it because it's like the fear is that they'll either become lesbians or sex workers. And it's like this idea, it's all built around this fear of women's physicality being linked to sexuality and this utter petrified fear of sexuality and this idea of women being in a state of not being controlled. And sports would somehow unlock the potential of women to be wild. And therefore, they had to be kept under lock and key, whether that lock and key was the corset around their body or whether that lock and key was on the gym keeping them from playing. And I have one example of this that I did want to read. This is from a very, very widespread, a very, very popular magazine called the American Christian Review. And what it did was it diagrammed the 12-step downfall of any woman who dared engage in the sinful world of croquet. And it's truly a slippery slope. This, I'm just going to go through it real quick. It goes, 1, social party. 2, social and play party. 3, croquet party. 4, picnic and croquet party. 5, picnic, croquet, and dance. 6, absence from church. It's a bit of a leap. I don't know how they got there. 7, immoral conduct. 8, exclusion from the church. 9, this one's my favorite, is more croquet. 10, poverty. It's a hell of a leap. I don't know. 11, shame and disgrace. And 12, ruin. And you thought it was just croquet. But an invention was actually created at this time that completely changed the relationship of women to sports, and that was the bicycle. And you go back and read at that time, it's fascinating because you have the suffragette movement that's at this time pushing for some form of women's equality. And the leading suffragettes, like Susan B. Anthony, like she said, the invention of the bicycle did more for women's equality than I ever could. It's a hell of a statement. Elizabeth Cady Stanton said, when women finally win the right to vote, they're going to go to the polls riding a bicycle. And in response to that, the Journal of American Medicine actually published an article warning women to not ride bicycles. And they warned them on two fronts. First, they said that, and this is, keep in mind, these are doctors writing this. They said if women landed wrong on a bicycle, they ran the risk of becoming infertile. They actually said that their uteruses could implode by falling wrong on a bicycle. So that's one thing. And the second thing they wrote about was an actual medical condition that they deemed, quote, that only affected women, called the bicycle face. And it consisted of, quote, a protruding jaw, wild staring eyes, and a strained expression. Basically, you become Dick Vitale if you ride a bicycle. And what you see throughout the 20th century is that women's sports is constantly, it's not just a question of can women play, should women play, it's always connected to what's the position of women in society as a whole. And it's like up and down, backwards and forwards. So for example, like in the 1940s, when women were working in factories during World War II, it's no coincidence that's also when you get the All-American Girls Baseball League, as highlighted in the movie, A League of Their Own. Or the 1950s, when there was this big push to put women back into the home as a more consumer society was developed. There was also a push at that time to actually ban women from the Olympics entirely. And while this is all happening, African-American women are developing their own athletic dynasties at historically black colleges in a way that has been utterly underwritten about. For example, there was a school called Tennessee State where their team was called the Tiger Bells. And at this HBCU, you had athletes like Wilma Rudolph and Wyoming Attias ran to Olympic glory. This school, which had only 2,000 students, at one point had 40 Olympians. 2,000 students. They had 40 Olympians, over 20 medalists, and some of the great runners in history, really developing this kind of like independent athletic dynasty with the safe haven of an HBCU, which is really a remarkable story in and of itself. And this is what you see throughout the 20th century until the passage of Title IX legislation, which is, of course, intimately linked to the women's liberation movement. And you had athletes like Billie Jean King who are part of that movement. And Title IX legislation, the statistics around it are just remarkable, and it's why it's something that I think constantly needs to be defended. Because if their statistics show that, you know, young girls who play sports less likely to teenage pregnancy, eating disorders, all the rest, like it's incredible positive for young girls. Today, 1 out of 3 young girls play youth sports. Before Title IX was passed, that number was 1 out of 34. So you think about that, 1 out of 3, 1 out of 34, legislation that literally changed the quality of life for tens of millions of women. And today, if people might have seen in the news that the U.S. Women's National Soccer Team just filed complaint with the EEOC about wage discrimination, I mean, that is part of that history as well, because U.S. women's soccer in this country has always been in a position where they not only succeed on the field, winning multiple World Cups and Olympics, but they've also had to fight off the field for respect. In 1996, for example, they actually had threatened to go on strike. They didn't show up to practice because they were not even being given meal money as part of the Atlanta Games. They were being paid $1,000 a month, and they were only going to get a bonus if they won the gold medal. Meanwhile, the men got a bonus just for showing up. And so in 1996, they went out on strike, and they came up with that idea after talking to who else? Billie Jean King, who founded the first ever women's athletic sports union. And she said to them, the only power you actually have is the power to be loud, proud, and to not work. And so you look at what the soccer players are doing today, which is not only filing this discrimination suit, but also coordinating that with interviews and discussion. I mean, that is about taking that history and applying it to the present, because that's really what it's all about. Because I think one of the most interesting things about today and this moment we're in right now is that you're seeing a new generation of athletes actually use their platform to try to do something to make a difference. And we could talk about this, but everything from NBA players standing with the Black Lives Matter movement, using social media, posing with hoodies as the Miami Heat did after Trayvon Martin was killed, to the Missouri players last fall, literally going on strike against racism at Mizzou and bringing a major university system to its knees. I mean, these are all things that show that athletes are starting to, like they did in the late 60s and early 70s, realize their cultural capital and realize that they can actually do something about what's happening in the world around them, that they don't have to just be athletes and that they don't have to just role model this idea of athletic success and having a car or whatever, money, whatever, but they can role model the idea that anybody can stand up like these guys did here and make a difference. And that's what I think makes this moment that we're in, particularly when there's so much pessimism and cynicism about mainstream politics and what goes on in Washington. And I know so many of us, I know I was raised to think that politics was just what guys did with bad haircuts on Capitol Hill, but this idea of people actually reclaiming their space and saying, I'm going to stand up and I'm going to use the platform that I have. And that's also why it's so heavily policed and why athletes still are derided for daring to speak out. And it's also why knowing this history is so important. Like when the Missouri players said, we're not going to play because we have a serious problem with racism on this campus, one of the headlines in ESPN said, unprecedented. That's how they described it. Unprecedented. When in reality, this was actually quite common in the late 60s and early 70s. I wrote an article, right? I listed them off one by one about all the times in the late 60s and early 70s athletes went on strike. I mean, at Howard University, they even had a bonfire of their athletic gear right in the middle of the football field because they were protesting racism on campus. And so this is something that there's actually a tradition at work. And it's so important for athletes to know this tradition, and it's so important for fans to know this tradition because it makes you realize that people are really standing on the shoulders of giants and that the legacy of people like Jackie Robinson, like Billie Jean King, like Wyoming Attias, like Muhammad Ali, like Tommy Smith, John Carlos, and Peter Norman, that these are actually living histories. And the idea of a living history is something that's, I think, very threatening to the powers that be, and it's also, I think, the most powerful arrow in our collective quiver. And that's why I treasure history, not because of what it was, but because of what it is. And that's why, like, the quote that I have on my wall in my little study in my house is a quote by the historian Howard Zinn, who once said, I study history not because I want to learn more about the past, but because I want to change the future. So thank you very much. I appreciate your time. I'm happy to take. Happy to take any questions that folks have. And I'll just so you know, I'll throw up your hands. I'll see you. I'll keep calling on you. I think Professor has the mic, and I know with sports talks that sometimes it can be, a little male centric. So I'm going to try to practice what we call progressive stacking, where I'll call on folks, make sure we get men and women both asking questions, and also if you have a comment, disagree with something I said, don't hesitate to do that either. And just don't ask me who's going to win the game tonight, because I have no idea. That was a joke. So start in the back, and then the gentleman there. And if folks could say their name, I'd appreciate it, since y'all know my name. I'll know yours.
I think it's okay. Sorry. Hi, my name is Tykira Carter. I'm a sophomore here.
Hey.
My question for you is, are your writings and sports reviews one that come easy to you, or does it take time to brainstorm your thoughts and ideas, like in the process?
I mean, honestly, that's a great question. To me, the biggest challenge is not what am I going to write about, but what am I not going to write about? Like, it just, especially these days, it just feels like today, if people have followed this thing about the big, like, financial leak with Panama and bringing down governments across the world. People have seen that, like, the massive media leak. Like, just today it popped up that this is affecting Gianni Infantino, who's the new head of FIFA, who is supposed to be the clean guy coming in after Sepp Blatter. What a surprise, corruption in FIFA. But I'm, like, you know, traveling here today to do this talk, and I'd just written this article about the U.S. women and their struggle, and I'm just like, shit, do I have time for this too? And then it's like, you know, the Olympics are coming in Brazil, and it's like, shit, you know, I gotta, you know, get on that too. And so there's so much happening, and it's really like trying to figure, it's a much tougher question for me than what am I gonna write about, because it's more like, what's the key issue of this moment? Because you can't write about everything. But what you can do is try to figure out what is going to connect with people in a way that matters. And sometimes you don't know what it is. I mean, like I wrote something like I spent a lot of time on one piece about Brazil. Not a lot of folks read it. I spent like 10 minutes writing about how stupid I think the Lakers bro code is with D'Angelo Russell. If people saw that story, it took like 12 minutes just basically like throwing up my thoughts on a piece of paper. And that was the most read article at The Nation's website, which is kind of hilarious because The Nation's like a political thing. And so it's like the number three article is like what does Hillary have to do to secure her delegates? Number two article is like immigration in a Texas coastal town. And number one, it says the Lakers can shove their bro code. And it's like, damn, which one of these does not belong? So you never know what's gonna connect. And so a lot of it is trial and error, trust your instincts, but trust your instincts also isn't code for you're always going to be right. So it's just trying to keep learning. Oh, please. Yeah.
Yes, James Santemeyer. Could you comment on how you feel Harry Edwards, Jack Scott, and the whole athletic revolution in the 60s plays into this?
Yeah, I just interviewed Dr. Harry Edwards on my podcast. If people want to check it out, edgeofsportspodcast.com. Just throwing it out there. Harry Edwards was the person who helped organize this moment, was the key architect, as he's referred to, of the Olympic Project for Human Rights. And you could make a case that Dr. Harry Edwards was also somebody who we wouldn't have this discipline called sports sociology without Dr. Harry Edwards. Dr. Harry Edwards is, he was like 6'8". He was an amazing athlete himself. And he made this decision. He grew up poor in East St. Louis. And he made the decision to take a grant and get his PhD instead of go to the NFL, which was there for him to do. And I've interviewed Harry Edwards a lot. And there are times where I've talked to him and he's like, I remember like 10 years ago when I talked to Harry Edwards. And he was like, man, sometimes I wish I'd gone to the NFL. And then like I was talking to him the other week and he said, you know, I'm still thinking and talking and I'm really glad I didn't go to the NFL. So it's interesting. His own thinking about his path has, as we know more about football and health and all the rest of it, has also changed. And Jack Scott, Jack Scott's part of this story too, because Jack Scott, he wrote a book called The Athletic Revolution, which was very influential in the early 70s. And he was made the athletic director at Oberlin College. And one of the things he did, and this is like 1972, I believe, is he hired Tommy Smith to be the track coach, an unemployed Tommy Smith, who at the time was mourning the death of his mother, who had passed away in rural Georgia. And one of the things that Tommy felt like led to her heart attack was that people, because of what he did in the Olympics, anonymous people were sending her dead animals on a regular basis in the mail, like just torturing this poor woman. And she died of a heart attack, and Tommy was distraught. And here's Jack Scott hiring him over, which is also kind of crazy if you think about it, because this is one of the great track and field athletes in the history of this country, and he's teaching track at a Division III school like Oberlin. It's like, it's a very odd match. And the other thing Jack Scott did, and I think he was ahead of his time on this, was it didn't last at Oberlin, but I really do think it was ahead of his time. He pretty much disbanded organized sports as we know them and instead put in a system where every student had to play something. So this idea of exercise being a part of the curriculum of being a student at Oberlin. And it didn't take, the boosters hated it, got rid of it. People wanted their teams and whatnot, even at a D3 school like Oberlin, which gives you an idea of how much resistance there would be if, say, at UConn, if someone said to Gino Auriemma, it's like, yeah, basketball's going to be open now to whoever wants to play. I think, I don't know how Gino would feel about that. But they were crucial to this whole discussion because they did something which I really think that folks are starting to do today, too, and that because there are new sports sociology departments happening on campuses across this country, and programs like the one that you guys have here. I mean, I don't know for sure if that program didn't exist 10 years ago in sports communication. I'm guessing it didn't. It didn't, because I'm seeing that across the country. And I think what's so interesting about it is that it's creating a kind of academic scaffolding for student athletes who want to speak out about the injustices they see. And just one example of that is people I'm guessing are familiar with the Northwestern athletes who attempted to organize themselves in a union. That all started when the quarterback, Kane Coulter, and a couple of his classmates were in a sports labor law class. And they're listening to all this, like their teacher talk about sports labor law. And they were like, this sounds very familiar to some of the things we're dealing with. And so that idea of there being this kind of academic scaffolding for athletes. And the last thing I'll say, I'm sorry for going on so long, but one of the really exciting things about this trip, I was just in Kansas, is that I spoke in a sports history class, and there were like 8 members of the basketball team in the class. And they were like all part of the discussion, like the discussions we're having here. Now that's not very common as far as big time schools where the athletes are that engaged in like political discussions about sports. But it's also something that, wow, if it could happen at Kansas, I mean, it could happen anywhere.
Dave, I got one for you. Going back to the early 80s, like Michael Jordan and the start of sponsorships and endorsements, how much do you think athletes having sponsorships, media deals, and has had a chilling effect on athletes being more political, taking on causes over the past generation?
Oh, I mean, that's a great question. I mean, definitely in the 80s, it's so interesting because I think often when we talk about athletes in politics, people are like, oh, it's not like it was in the 60s. I mean, you hear that a lot. But it's true that it's not like it was in the 60s, but it's also not like it was in the 90s. Like if you're looking at a graph and the 60s are here and the 90s are here, we're kind of like here now. And it's not bad. I mean, so it's interesting because when the big sponsorship deals started and Nike became this behemoth, I mean, you did see this real downward pressure on athletes where it's like if you say anything more than, well, we play one game at a time, good Lord willing, we play one game at a time, good Lord willing, you know, you're not going to get that deal. And the couple of athletes who did speak out in the 1990s, people like Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf and the person you and I were talking about, Craig Hodges, who found themselves pushed out of the league for being political. Like I remember hearing like in 2003, athletes saying, like, you don't want to end up like Craig Hodges. You know, and that was like a decade earlier. It was almost like he was this ghost story. Like, you don't want to end up like Craig Hodges. But what's so interesting now, I think personally, is that athletes, partly because they have this independent source of income, coupled with, I think, a more intense political situation with issues like Black Lives Matter, LGBT struggles, women fighting for equality in sports, coupled with social media, where they feel like they don't have to go through traditional avenues of media, means that they feel more comfortable speaking out. Just kind of an interesting giveth, taketh away flip side of the sponsorship deals. Like if you're Kevin Durant and you have a lifetime contract with, what is it, Nike, Kevin Durant? Like with whatever company has him. Or if you're, you know, Steph Curry and people are telling you you have, what they say, he's worth like $12 billion to Under Armour. Like they worked it out, like some crazy number like that. Like all of a sudden that actually even gives you a little more leeway to sort of explore the studio space, you know what I'm saying? And figure out what you can say and what you can get away with. That's my take on it. I don't know. Yeah, you told what we were talking about before? Oh, you're giving me a softball? Oh, to talk about what we were talking about before. Yeah, I mean, it's so interesting because one of the quotes that's most attributed, like that is most fastened, most tattooed to Michael Jordan is when he said, Republicans buy sneakers too. And people might have heard that before. And he said it in the context of being asked to endorse Harvey Gantt, who was the mayor of Charlotte, North Carolina, who was running for Senate against Jesse Helms, who was an arch segregationist, like and really just an open racist. And it was the sort of thing where people, I think, would have been, it was such a bold thing to say, Republicans buy sneakers too, because he wasn't saying, well, I don't agree with Harvey Gantt. And he wasn't saying, well, actually, Jesse Helms has some ideas about small government that I support. What he was saying was, Republicans buy sneakers too. I don't want to offend anybody, so I'm not going to say anything. And the story that Paul and I were talking about before this event was a story that I had heard where a year or two after this took place, and he said, Republicans buy sneakers too, Michael Jordan was at a very posh party in North Carolina where Jesse Helms was. And he went up to Jesse Helms, and this is Michael Jordan, you know, the most famous person in the history of North Carolina. And he goes up and says, like, hey, hello, Senator Helms, how you doing? And Senator Helms looked at him and just said, hey, George, how you doing, George? Good to see you, George. And walked away. And Michael Jordan looked at the person he was with and goes, is that guy senile or something? Call me George? And the person said, no, he calls all black men George. Because that's what used to be like in the 1930s and 40s, what you would call the porters on trains. Because George Pullman ran all the trains, and so all of the porters were called George, as if they were like just parts of George Pullman, which is why if you ever get to see it, there's a great side point, but there's a great HBO movie about A. Philip Randolph who organized the porters, and it's called A Thousand Black Men Named George or A Thousand Men Named George, and it's a very good, worth seeing. Andre Brower is A. Philip Randolph. That wasn't asked for, but it's very good. But yeah, so that's part of the Jordan political legacy.
The other thing about Jordan that you talk about in your film is at the Olympics when he draped himself in the flag, but not really as an act of naked patriotism, but really because he was covering up a competitor's logo in order to protect his connection to the Nike brand.
That's right. That's right. And it's the Nike power is really something. Like, I live in D.C., and one of the things that people are dealing with now on the Georgetown campus is that there is a push by some of the student athletes to say, to actually make demands of Nike, because Nike just removed themselves from something called the Workers' Rights Consortium, which is this sweatshop oversight board. And the school has come down like a ton of bricks on athletes who did things like put black tape over their swooshes, like a really like brutal crackdown, and including a meeting of all the athletes and telling them not to discuss this or organize around this or be public around this, or there would be hell to pay. Worth pointing out that, you know, John Thompson, the legendary Georgetown coach, is on the board of Nike. And it's also so fascinating because if you think about it, this is Georgetown, one of the great academic, prestigious, I should say, because I don't believe in great when it comes to colleges. It's what you get out of college, not the name on your sweatshirt. I really do believe that. But it's like this prestigious college, Georgetown. And if you think about that, you've got coaches who allegedly are supposed to be like, you know, professors telling students not to talk to other students about politics, which is kind of a stunning thing when you think about the position of student athletics in this country. Any women with questions? I hate to be that blatant about it. Sorry. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Marika David. I'm an adjunct here.
Hi.
To kind of, I guess, tie a couple of things together, what did you think about Serena Williams and Maria Sharapova and the whole controversy about the earnings in
I mean,
the endorsements?
Wow. You mean the rivalry between Sharapova and Serena, where Serena wins every match? You mean that rival? No. Although I did find it fascinating when Maria Sharapova just got pinched for taking the, you know, what she took. That Serena was one of her defenders. I thought that was really positive in a lot of ways, and showed a certain degree of solidarity when there was a big pile-on on Maria Sharapova. And I don't think anyone would have begrudged Serena to be like, oh, gee, I wonder what everybody would be saying if it was me who turned up with a PED test or what have you. But about the earnings thing, it's not disconnected from, although it's more complicated, it's not disconnected from the soccer one. Because with the soccer one, it's just so blatant. Like, not only are the women more successful than the men in this country by a country mile, like not even close, but 25.4 million people watch the finals of the Women's World Cup. That's the most number of people who've ever watched a soccer game in the history of this country. So it's like you get more eyeballs, you have more success, and you make 40 cents on the dollar to what the men make. I mean, so that's just like so blatant, it's there. With women's tennis, what's interesting is like as Serena said this, and my experience, although it's anecdotal, is certainly true. There are so many people who, if you take the Williams sisters out of the equation, they're not even watching tennis. And historically, at different times, it's like on a graph, if you saw it, it's like there are times where women's tennis does get higher ratings than men's tennis. And it all depends on who's playing and the personalities involved. And interestingly enough, like when we're talking about the best of three sets, best of five sets, the best of three sets, one of the things that does is it makes something like what Serena did last year with almost winning the Grand Slam, and it makes what Martina did in her prime, where she won 97% of all the matches she played in over like a six-year period, like something. It makes it actually much more difficult to dominate if you're playing best of three versus best of five. If you think about it, like, it's the difference between, say, like a best of seven NBA series versus a best of five. Like the cream will rise to the top if the longer you play. And that makes Serena's dominance all the more remarkable and makes what she's done all the more remarkable. Like, I wrote a piece recently. This one got me in some trouble with some folks, where I really think Serena, and I know you didn't ask this, but I think Serena in a lot of ways is like the Muhammad Ali of our times. Now, that doesn't mean she's Muhammad Ali, because it's not the 1960s and she's not trying to not fight in a foreign war, you know, so it's like there's too many differences to count. But the idea of somebody willing to tie their athletic greatness to causes bigger than themselves is something that Serena has done with this organization called the Equal Justice Initiative, EJI, and that works to fight mass incarceration. And it's a pretty remarkable way in which she tries to leverage her particular platform to do something. And it makes her, I think, singular in so many respects in this landscape. And it's also difficult to imagine a tennis player 10 years ago doing what she's doing now in terms of mixing the sports and the politics. So that's kind of what I think about that.
And then, since we're talking about Serena,
yes,
and tennis and corsets, yes. Can you speak to how women athletes in particular are represented differently than men, and the politics of that in the media?
Yeah, I mean, it's so interesting, because it's like this is also something that through social media is now being challenged in a way that's different. But I'll tell you this: people, if you get the chance, go to a website. I see folks with computers and taking notes and stuff. Like, the Tucker Center at the University of Minnesota. The Tucker Center is the only academic institution devoted entirely to women's sports. And one of the studies that they did, which was so fascinating, is they set about 7 or 8 years ago of trying to answer this question, like, do you need sex? Some would say, do you need sexism to sell women's sports? And this has been like this long-standing debate, if you will, about women's sports. Like, do you need to actually have, for conventionally attractive, read white, read blonde athletes to be able to sell women's sports to an audience? And without that kind of, without it having an element of, you know, Maxim magazine to it, like, are you able to actually have women's sports be something that's viable economically? And they said, you know, this debate is tired. We're enough of this. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a massive field study and ask people why they do or why they don't consume women's sports. And one of the things that they found out, I just thought this was really fascinating, was that sexism, if you will, or objectification, however we want to put it, is very good at selling individual athletes, like a Danica Patrick, for example. Things of that nature. Maria Sharapova is a great example of that, who, you know, gets higher commercial monies by a country mile despite a fraction of the success as Serena Williams. But it's actually very bad when it comes to actually selling the sports themselves. That sexism, that the idea of saying, like, well, I'm going to, you know, I'm Ronda Rousey, I'm going to put on body paint and be in the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue, that actually hurts the sport itself. And you do often hear athletes like Rousey say, you know, this is about raising the profile of MMA, this is about raising the profile. But it's like, no, you're raising the profile on yourself, but you're actually hurting the sport. And they came to this conclusion, not because it was their opinion or not because they don't believe in objectification, but they came to this opinion by talking to thousands of people and finding out that the biggest consumers of women's sports, the two biggest, are one, women, big surprise, and two, men with daughters, because they found like this was a space that they felt like they could go to with their daughters and establish some form of bonding and communication with them through sports, which is actually one of the great things about sports, and why I love sports, is that it can create bonds and connections where sometimes there's only awkward silences. And men with daughters found women's sports as a place where they could bring their daughters. And when you hyper-objectify women athletes, it tended to make those men with daughters withdraw from the sports themselves because they didn't want, they were not comfortable in that kind of environment, and they didn't think it was the right kind of role modeling for their kids. So that's what's interesting, I think, about this moment is that there's just more space to talk about it. When before it was kind of like a kind of my way or the highway approach, and heaven forbid what would happen to anybody who said, gee, maybe Danica Patrick posing, you know, in a red leather bikini on top of a car isn't the best thing for women athletes. Like you'd say that and people would be like, how dare you criticize Danica Patrick, instead of, you know, saying like, this is actually not good for trying to create more audiences for women's sports and moving out of, you know, the 1950s in terms of how we look at women athletes. And then that gentleman there who's been very patient, but sorry, go ahead.
While we're in the basketball championships and going back to yes. the '60s, can you speak about the significance and the importance of Texas Western's 1966 championship?
Oh yeah, I mean I can speak about it because this will make me a little bit upset if I talk about it, but it was the Texas Western was the first all black starting five to win the NCAA championship. They beat the all white starting five of Adolph Rupp and the University of Kentucky. The movie Glory Road, I criticize sports movies a lot. I actually think that's a pretty good one if people see Glory Road. I was saying I was getting a little upset talking about it because that took place in Cole Fieldhouse on the University of Maryland's campus, which is about 10 minutes from my house. And they're about to tear it down to create an indoor football practice facility, which is the sort of thing that makes me want to kick windows because it's like so disrespectful to the history of it, and why does everything have to bend for football? It just bothers me so much, especially because an indoor facility in Maryland is not, I mean, what the hell? It's not like we're in North Dakota or something. It's like if it's Michigan, I can hear you, but it's like snows like for 3 days, and it's like, oh, we need an indoor facility. But it's really for recruits. You can say, look at this great structure we have. But it was so important at the time. I mean, not only because it was so much of a part of the 1960s and it gave like this impression that there was an old way of doing things, segregation, particularly in the Southeastern Conference and all the schools in the Southeast, and that if you were going to compete, and Bear Bryant was looking at this very closely, and Adolph Rupp as well, who's often looked at as being like this staunch segregationist, racist, was also looking at this very closely. And so a lot of these schools actually took steps to integrate for the first time because of that game. And the other part of that story, which is so good, and this is a minor part of it, but one that I find really fascinating, partly because I love El Paso so much, because that's where Texas Western became UTEP, University of Texas, El Paso, is that, I mean, it was really a product. I mean, people think of Texas, and they have all kinds of stereotypes about Texas. Don't mess with Texas, where's your gun, all the rest of it. But El Paso is actually this really interesting border community. It's right on the border, and it's actually the two biggest border cities in the world. Like cities that face each other across a border are El Paso and Juarez. And so it's a very unique culture that was able to take black players largely from the northeast of the United States and make them feel so at home when they're going to Texas thinking, oh shit, how long are we gonna last in Texas? And going there and being like, this is our new home. And a lot of those players actually ended up living in El Paso. And so that's a beautiful kind of part of it too, of this idea of the mixing of cultures, Mexican, Texas, white guys, black kids from the Northeast, and how there was already this experience in El Paso of people figuring out how to get along with each other and communicate. So, I mean, it really couldn't be more important. And it also, people forget this too when they talk about that, is that the captain of that, you know the captain of that Kentucky team was? Pat Riley, there we go. We got some sports trivia people. It was Pat Riley. And Pat Riley, of course, you know, very influential to this date. And that's pretty cool. I saw their hands.
Thanks.
Yeah.
So Dan,
and then up here after that, yeah.
Dan, sports broadcasting student here.
Hey, Dan.
So Dr. Miller in the front there, we take a sports history class with him this module. He had a brilliant idea of making us read like 15,000 pages in the first 3 days of class.
Jesus.
It was genius because it alienated half the class right away. But anyway,
nice.
We got to pick one of your books. So Welcome to the Terradome was my choice. Right. So it brought me to gut-wrenching tears. And now I'm a grown man that cries easy, but the part about Eitan Thomas when he went to D.C. and talked about bringing the Bush administration to the ghetto was unbelievably disturbing. So as a sports fan, I spent a lot of time admiring what sports gives to us, but a lot more, the majority of the time I spent screaming at what needs to change. Very curious, and I know your big thing is getting these encouraging athletes to speak out. You could go tomorrow on SportsCenter and say, this is going to change today in sports. What's the one thing that changes?
Something I could make change or something that I want to change? Which one?
A change
like,
that...
Do I have like some sort of Harry Potter-esque power?
Yeah, yeah.
To wave a wand? Oh, my... And is it something structural that I can change with this wand, or is it like the sort of thing where I'm like a puppeteer of athletes who say stuff because I or do stuff because I want them to?
Well, there's a couple examples. There's like professional tennis, fans can't move while watching the sport. You're not allowed to move, right? For hours at a time. Exploding salaries in baseball while we have huge issues in this country such as starvation. You know, anything that would change in sports.
Yeah, the temptation is to actually do something that was actually was submitted by President Obama in the latest budget, actually. So it's not that far-fetched, but a banning on public funds for stadiums is something that I think is a absolute no-brainer given the crises that we face. But I'm not going to do that one because they're also a group of owners who are trying to get away from that model too. Because there's one, I interviewed an owner for the Sixers, Ed Snyder, they did private money to build the new stadium for the Sixers, and he was just like, yeah, it's more headaches than it's worth from people like you when we use public money. I was like, gee, thanks. This interview's going well. So I won't do that. There's two different things. If I could wave a magic wand, I would have the NBA and the NFL fund their own damn minor leagues and stop using our institutions of higher learning as the minor leagues for our professional sports clubs. It's weird that we do it that way. The United States is the only country that operates this way. And I think it would free up a profound number of resources and a profound number of sporting opportunities for people. And it also creates the opportunity where if you're 16, 17 years old, like in other sports, like baseball, like hockey, like tennis, like golf, and you're good enough to play and you want to make money for your family, you do it. You join the minor leagues of the Chicago Bulls instead of going to, you know, the University of Kansas. And I think those are things worth doing. And that doesn't mean people can't still go to college and play sports, but it would just be done in a very, very different kind of way. And it's a problem to me. It's like we don't look at the bigger issue. Like I told you I was just at Kansas. It's like 3% African American at Kansas, like in terms of the student body. And if you took out the athletes, it goes down to like 1.9%. And so it's this really screwed up kind of thing where, and there's just an article, I was tweeting it nonstop if people want to look at it, but there was this family, this two professors at Michigan State named the McCormicks, and they had this sort of like come to Jesus moment, if you will, at Michigan State when they were like looking around, they were like, my goodness, there's like 2% of the students at this school are black. Everybody on the football field practically is black. Everybody in the stands is white. So they're an institution for higher learning getting brain damage for our entertainment at a school, and they're not being compensated for it. Like, what's wrong here? And so that's what I'd like to see change, because when you take a step back from it, it is so effed up the way the system works. I heard Dick Vitale this morning talking about, like, going nonstop. He's up all night, Villanova, baby. And he was like, I love college basketball. How you can have your NBA? The passion, baby. The passion. No one's sleeping. The confetti. It's amazing, baby. And you know what, baby? It's made me rich, baby. And then Mike and Mike laugh. No, Dickie V. And I'm just like, what an asshole. Like, he didn't make that shot last night. That was Chris Jenkins who made that shot. You know, that was Marcus Page who made that double pump shot, you know, to tie the game at the end. You know, they're not compensated for that, but Dickie V got paid. And we're supposed to feel good about that? That's not right. You know, not when every inch of their bodies looks like it's covered in logos. And Mike Krzyzewski gets $2.5 million a year from Nike. Well, he doesn't have to wear a swoosh. His players wear the swoosh. So that is the magic wand. Now, as far as the players, it's connected to that. Like you said, if I could players do something, because it wouldn't take a lot. It would take the teams who are going to play in the Final Four before they get head on the court saying, we need to sit down at a negotiating table before we play. And then you're talking about 89% of the NCAA's operating revenue is all tied up in this tournament. And believe me, it would be like Missouri. Like, you saw how quickly the discussion changed at Missouri when they said they weren't going to play. You know, I did a lot of research into Missouri, and one of the things I found is that campus has this brutal history of racism going back decades. And the sort of very, very bitter joke among black students at Missouri going back decades was, had as an administrator at Missouri say F you, they say thank you for your input. So it's just like decades of these complaints and just a lot of nodding of the head, being like, wow, you're so right, we're gonna do a study. And then in the corner of their mouths, they're like, you know, they're gonna graduate soon anyway, so who cares? And yet, and then the players, though, on the football team, which, by the way, 69% African-American, say that they're not going to play. Their white teammates stand with them and say, these are our brothers. If they're upset, we're upset. And next thing you know, the president's expendable, just like that. And so that's what I would like to see, is more of that. And that's also why that freaked so many people out when Missouri did that. You know, that's why Spike Lee is like rushing to make a documentary about it. You know, it's that's why the new coach at Missouri had to have in his contract that he wouldn't support any players' strike. Like this crazy thing they made him sign to even be there. I mean, it's so that's what I'd like to see. Because I think that's where athletes are the most abused in this country and also where they have the most power, potentially. Because so much of this massive multi-billion dollar NCAA edifice is dependent on the compliance of basically of teenagers. Hi.
Hello. Hi. I'm Laura Biatowicz. I'm a media literacy graduate student here.
Hello.
Hi. Okay. So my question kind of stemmed from the fact that I just recently stayed at the Olympic Training Center and there was many Paralympian athletes there.
Mm-hmm.
So what are your thoughts about media coverage dominance on major television networks of male athletes versus the coverage that women athletes get and also athletes with disabilities?
Yeah, I mean, we have if sports were like a diet, it would be like we would just be eating carbs all the time, like just bread. I mean, because it's pretty much, you know, it's typical sports media at a typical basis. I mean, it really, like even baseball is getting marginalized. I mean, it's pretty much, it's football dominantly. It's football, and it's basketball. And football, it's a whole separate conversation. Like 43 of the 50 top watched sporting events last year were all NFL games. 43 out of 50. And that's a whole, I think, interestingly separate discussion. Like the more we know about football, the less parents are letting their kids play football, the more people are watching football, which is a whole separate interesting discussion worth having. But in this particular case, what the media is doing is it doesn't just tail that audience, it creates it. Like, doesn't just tail it, it creates it. And it creates an audience where only these few sports are even discussed, which gets to some of my deeply, deeply, deeply contradictory feelings about the Olympics. Because, I mean, I hate what the Olympics does to cities. I've covered every Olympics since 2002, and I've seen some really disgusting things, like homeless people in Greece living in dilapidated Olympic structures, entire communities in Brazil that have been torn to the ground to make way for Olympic facilities. The whole Zika virus that people are talking about that's rooted in Rio, like a lot of the roots of that have to do with the amount of standing water and lack of plumbing that exists in Brazil and in Rio. And I saw these areas, and one of the reasons why it exists like that is because they've haphazardly torn down so many communities and torn up the plumbing as a way to actually force people to leave their communities, that it's created just these cesspools of insects and waste. And so it's like no one's really talking about that. It's like and that's one of the reasons why also, if people have seen the news, it's that Zika is not, people are like, oh, it's going to move north, it's going to spread throughout the United States. It's actually not moving much past these areas in Rio, where, and one of the reasons why it's been so difficult to eradicate there, I mean, it's been easier to eradicate in like Costa Rica than it is in Rio, precisely because of the Olympics. But at the same time, what did the Olympics give you? I mean, it gives you an opportunity to break out of that high carb diet and see these different kinds of sports and actually get into these different kinds of sports in a really exciting way. And then all of a sudden we're all enraptured, maybe not with like curling, but like with some of the stuff that makes its way. I mean, it's amazing how intense we get about sports that otherwise we ignore. And it's one of the few times where women athletes really do have center stage in a way that's very dynamic and interesting and fun. So that's, and Paralympians as well. I mean, it would be actually be great if there could be a bigger moment for Paralympians in this context. And actually there's a whole discussion. I wish I was more literate on talking about it, but I've spoken both to Paralympians and people who work for them, and the way in which the Paralympics are even used by Olympic organizers as a way to sell their project, and in a way that sometimes feels very exploitative. But that doesn't take away from the heart and soul and passion that people infuse in it. And I think that's kind of like a bigger point here is that, you know, I'm a big believer that sports is, you know, it's like fire, and fire can cook a meal or fire can burn down your house. It's what you do with it. And I'd like to see us try to figure out how we can take what we like about sports and reclaim it instead of just throwing out the baby with the bathwater and saying sports is bad, because it's not bad. It ain't good, but it's not bad. And we got to figure out how to break that apart and challenge what we don't like about it to change.
All right. The global setting is fascinating, but the local setting right here, the man on the stage. When did you come to this crossroads of sports and politics and society, and what made you say and act, I'm going to explore this, and maybe what's the next chapter in your exploration?
Well, I'll tell you, like I, in the talk, I said the Mahmoud Abdul Rauf story, which is a real story about me seeing that and being like, wow, what is this? But honestly, like 2 years after Rauf did what he did, the book came out, which I could not recommend more strongly. And it's just a very thin book. It's probably 200 pages long, or less. And it's about Muhammad Ali, and it's called Redemption Song, Muhammad Ali and the Story of the 1960s. And it's by an author named Mike Marcosi, who passed away last year. And it's a brilliant, exciting, interesting book. And I remember reading that and being like, whoa, this is like reading awesome sports writing. But I'm also learning a ton about like Vietnam and civil rights movement and all this stuff through sports. And reading that book for me was like a total revelation that it was possible to merge this stuff together in a way that actually excited the reader and wasn't either like dry and academic or depoliticized, which is what I felt like it was, or what the stuff I was finding anyway, was either like highly academic writing, sociological writing that I couldn't really penetrate with my feeble brain. And then the other side of it was the stuff that just was like, you know, like made for kids, basically, like candy coated, look at Jackie Robinson, steal home and end racism. You know, so Mike Marcosi changed me. As far as now, I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on now. I'm going back to Brazil in early May. I'm doing this podcast, which I'm just loving. It's like a new thing for me, what the young people are doing. And the other thing I've been working on for about 2 years is a political biography of Jim Brown, football player. And I stayed at Jim Brown's house for 5 days, like sleeping in his guest room under his pool and talking to him, and he's a very scary person. And but it's really a book about manhood, because it's a Jim Brown has always tried to represent this idea of being this kind of like real man, and this idea of like projecting your manhood as a way to fight racism. And there are also limitations that come with that too. Like Jim Brown's had a pretty horrific history with regards to violence against women. And so it's like trying to wrestle with all of that. Like Jim Brown was somebody who's done these amazing things that people don't know about. Like he brokered like the foundational gang truces in the 90s between the Bloods and the Crips. That was done at Jim Brown's house. And he's doing all this at a time, as Paul asked earlier, about this time when, you know, you didn't really have athletes doing anything political. And here's Jim Brown, this was also a time where young black kids were being demonized across this country, and the prison system was being built up. This is the 1990s, before we had phrases like mass incarceration and new Jim Crow and all the rest of it. And here's Jim Brown being like, no, these aren't super predators, these aren't animals, these aren't people, as in the words of Hillary Clinton, that we need to bring to heel. Like, these are people, and they need to be dealt with as part of the human family. And Jim Brown was doing that with some of the toughest people in South Central LA. And he was doing it also by being like, okay, you think being in a gang is bad? Well, I'm the baddest mother effer you've ever seen, and I'm gonna get you off of this gang track. And that is side by side with a way in which he dealt with women, which was not positive or constructive, particularly black women, in a way that was positive or constructive. So I'm trying to write a book about all that. So it hasn't been easy. It's taken me 2.5 years. It's been rejected by my publisher a couple of times. So it's been difficult. But, you know, that's part of the journey, so to speak.
Hi. I'm just curious.
What's your name?
Natalie.
Hey,
I'm in the graduate program here.
Cool.
Just curious to know, what research have you seen, like, globally? You talked a little bit about Vietnam, but any social movements through athletes maybe in other countries?
Yeah.
I'm specifically thinking of the only thing I know, which is Manny Pacquiao. I think his wife or himself have run for the mayor of their local town.
Yeah, Pacquiao in the Philippines.
In the Philippines. So is there any other movements like that happening? Mm-hmm. Maybe, you know, over in the UK with, like, soccer or anything like that?
Absolutely. I mean, in many ways, the United States is behind. That's a great question, by the way. And there are a lot of books I could recommend about this. There's a terrific book called Soccer Versus the State by Gabriel Kuhn, K-U-H-N, which is fantastic. That's about there's a book called Soccer in Sun and Shadow, which is about by Eduardo Galeano about soccer and social movement. It's also, like, incredibly readable and beautiful and lyrical and amazing. And so like the history of soccer and politics, I mean, dwarfs anything that this country has ever produced in terms of the intersection of sports and politics. And I mean, and in other countries as well that have more, like, civil wars and, like, actual violence in the streets between warring factions of people trying to control the government. You see in different ways that sports has been able to at some times be an instrument of peace where civil wars actually stop, like in the Ivory Coast when their team made a run in the World Cup, or in other countries like when Yugoslavia broke up in Serbia and Croatia. One of the things that they were able to do is, like, you had these rabid soccer fan clubs of primarily disenfranchised young men who were cheering like hell for their teams. Well, some of the teams were Serbian teams. Some of the teams were Croatian teams. They just armed the fan clubs, and they became death squads. And, you know, so, like, the direct connections. And there's, if people are interested in that, there's a lot of books that have written about that. But How Soccer Explains the World is a pretty good one by Franklin Foer, F-O-E-R. It's a global phenomenon, definitely. In this country, it's... It's weird, though, because the United States is such a towering country culturally from an international perspective. I mean, in terms of music, art, sports, and U.S. sports heroes tend to be people who go global in this day and age. It becomes a lens that I found is, like, the most accessible at the same time, because pretty much everybody has an opinion about LeBron James, but they might not about Manny Pacquiao, so...
I think we'll do, like, one more question. So is there something you've been dying to ask?
We'll do two, even if people leave.
Does somebody else have it?
Okay. Well, he's got a Mets hat. Is that a Mets hat? That, and I got to get that one. But oh, no, don't go. Oh.
So my name's Mike.
I know Connecticut's, like, contested territory.
I'm,
like,
from New York City, actually.
Yes.
Okay. Also interned at the Media Education Foundation.
Oh, wow.
Speaking about LeBron. In, I think it's Race, Power, and American Sports, you talk about how LeBron simultaneously wanted to be the first billionaire athlete as well as a kind of Muhammad Ali type figure.
Yeah.
I was wondering, how would you evaluate his progression in terms of activism? I know he didn't speak out on the Tamir Rice shooting. And also, maybe you could speak more broadly on the state of activism in sports. I know you did a little bit before, but I kind of tend to see it shifting more towards sporadic instances of activism as opposed to kind of sustained political activism. You could speak on that.
Now, what's your name?
Mike Krieger.
Mike, now that's a great question. Please ask yours as well. But just on that, I mean, we did that film. It was in Not Just a Game, where we talked about how LeBron, as a very young player, said both those two things. He said, I want to be the first billionaire athlete, and I want to be a global icon like Muhammad Ali. And those are two fine goals, but as I said in the film, it's like they don't necessarily go great together, because Ali became a global icon not for what he earned, but because for what he sacrificed. So you're not going to be a global icon like Muhammad Ali if you're also thinking, how am I going to get 10 zeros in my bank account? So, but the interesting thing about LeBron since then is, I mean, I've been, like, beyond impressed with some of the rhetoric of what he's done. And, yeah, so he didn't say anything about Tamir Rice. I mean, we can't ask athletes to be like Malcolm X with a jump shot. You know, it's asking too much. You know, it's like I tend to be more forgiving when athletes don't speak out, because I think oftentimes we run the risk of looking for to athletes to speak out and saying, why don't they speak out, instead of asking, well, why don't we speak out? Why don't our communities speak out? And why are we asking of athletes something that we don't ask of ourselves? So it's like always like not wanting to run that risk of thinking that athletes come down from like Planet Awesome to tell us what to do, because the whole history of everything, it's like, that's the thing I talk about Ali being a big pro wrestling fan and whatnot, is that it's like athletes do shape history, but what happens usually first is that history shapes athletes. And then they turn around and shape their world. So if we're not shaping the world off the athletic field, they're not going to turn around and then return the favor and use their cultural capital to do so. So I'm very forgiving of what LeBron hasn't done, and I've been very impressed with what he has done. And we'll have to, as far as like things that sustain themselves, I mean, I'm hopeful about issues, particularly around police brutality, actually fastening themselves as a regular part of athletic discourse. But, you know, we're going to really have to see what happens. And it definitely is something that happens in fits and starts. And if we want it to be more consistent, it really is going to be about what happens off the field. But it's a great question. And the other thing about LeBron, though, is like the reason why I wrote something where I was a little critical of him for not speaking about Tamir Rice, which goes a little bit against what I said. And the reason why I was even critical is because of his own words. Because I go back and read it sometimes, the essay that he wrote or as told to, I think, in Sports Illustrated when he went from Miami to Cleveland. And it's an amazing thing if you go back and read it and you think about, like, the power to say what he said. Like, he said, I don't care about the Cavaliers organization. I care about Cleveland. I'm not going back for the Cavs. I'm going back for Cleveland. I'm going back for the youth of Cleveland. And that's an amazing thing. But what it also does is it sets up, you're basically writing a check. And people are, a figurative check, a political check. And I think if you say that, it's not unreasonable for people to then say, well, then what do you say about this? I mean, you're actually, no one's like foisting leadership upon you. You're demanding it. And, you know, not to get all Spider-Man, but then it's like with great power comes great responsibility. And you want to know what's being said. Hi,
this is a really broad question. Maybe you can get a piece of it. So with the images you're showing and the images you're talking about, right, I mean, part of this violent white reaction is because these athletes are fundamentally challenging white supremacy, right, at this moment, right? And more specifically, the racist myth at the center of white supremacy, which is the supremacy of whites, right? So now I'm curious, like, what happens in the political economy of sports between the early 70s to now, when in many regards, like, this institutional racist discourse has so comfortably actually accommodated the current racial landscape of sports, and in some ways almost complementary mm-hmm. fashion, as you kind of hit at when you're talking about the college athletes, right? And because mm-hmm. so central to that discourse that you bring up about college athletes is mm-hmm. racial politics, right? I mean, mm-hmm. this is about them being young black men in particular, mm-hmm. not getting paychecks, right? So I'm wondering, like, what happens in that political economy over those 20 years between the early 70s and the 90s where that discourse mm-hmm. so fundamentally shifts?
I mean, what happens in the early 70s, early 90s, that's a great question. It's a fantastic question. It's something I think about a lot. I mean, I think about it all the time because you have two things happen simultaneously from the early 70s to early 90s. The first is that you have the utter explosion of salaries among athletes, where athletes for the first time can actually make a living. All athletes, black and white. You don't see till the early 70s. Like it used to be before the early 70s, if your name's not Mickey Mantle, you have a job in the offseason. You know, I interviewed this dude, Dave Megacy, who was a linebacker till 1969. In the offseason, he worked in a quarry. Like, he's breaking rocks and then going to play. But one of the reasons why their salaries exploded, I mean, really was because of unionization. And it was athletes like Curt Flood who were being inspired by the struggles of the black freedom struggle and the women's rights struggle and all the struggles, the anti-war movement. So you have struggle-inform athletes saying, we demand our fair share. And that happens throughout the 70s, but it also happens concurrent with this massive, massive backlash against those very movements of the 60s that built these union institutions and started to chop away at the unionization rate in this country. So it's a hell of a thing to happen side by side, and that you have the growth of sports really as this kind of like bread and circuses kind of thing, to the point of which that we're sucking money out of our very limited public till to build stadiums and all this infrastructure. These sort of modern coliseums, you know, for the purposes of distraction and entertainment, in the context of the lives for ordinary Americans, black and white, becoming much harder in terms of the amount of hours that you're asked to work, your lack of security, lack of healthcare, with the sort of rise of sports at the same time. But in a weird way, that also creates more power of the athletes themselves should they exercise it, because part of this like centralization of wealth and power at the top that we've seen over the last 30 years has also meant that there are very few avenues for people who grow up poor to actually have a platform and to have a mic in their hand and to speak about life from their perspective. And that's what one of the few places that does exist is in the world of athletics. It exists in entertainment as well, but I think in athletics it's always had more power because, you know, one can be an entertainer in some way or another for their entire lives, but athletes have such finite lives in terms of when they can earn and when they can be in the spotlight that I think we all instinctually feel that when somebody like LeBron James, who's, you know, now already 31 years old and he's already played, you know, more minutes in his career, I read this the other day, than like most people in the Basketball Hall of Fame, like he's already played more than the majority of people in the Basketball Hall of Fame in terms of pure minutes on a court, it's like when they speak out, they're actually risking something. And so because it has risk, it has power. And because, like, and so when LeBron James says something, like he was asked, like he was a great football player, and his son is a prodigy of an athlete as a basketball player. And he was asked, why doesn't your son play football? And he said, because I have money, so my kid doesn't have to play football. Like that sort of thing has a resonance that it just, that it doesn't have if it comes from another corner of society. Becomes debated, it becomes discussed, and it becomes part of the discourse in a way that it wouldn't if he wasn't LeBron James. That's a partial way to answer, but it is a fascinating like line graph, if you will, of you look at like 70s, 80s, 90s, and where salaries went, and also at the same time where general wages went, where resources went, and all the rest of it. And it's something to keep in mind of because that incredible differential in power also creates the opportunity, though, for athletes to speak out and speak to masses of people in a way that people in, like, a beltway bubble just cannot.
I think that's a perfect place to end it. If you think that this has been fantastic, please let Dave hear it.
I can't. I'm looking down because if I look up and see the one person not clapping, I'll be like, shit, what did I do? So, but thank you so much. This has been great. I really do appreciate it. Thank you.